That's right, I see the fire for that tune, the great sounds of coffee and of course Bojo Banton. But right now we're getting ready to speak to the founder, okay, of the great Mentivity. So make sure you keep it locked in. We're getting ready to talk about the project, how it all started, how it all happened. And of course, we have him live and direct on the show right now. So of course, introduce yourself.
How's it going? Yeah, say something to this. Founder, CEO of Mentivity, product of Southeast London.
Okay. So you know what? Lots of people are asking me, what is Mentivity?
Yeah, everyone always asks that because of the name. Everyone thinks it's just about men, but it's not. It's actually a play on words, so it's actually mentoring activity and combined. So came to me in a dream about 5 years ago now, and I just went with it, and it's just stuck. So it's a catchy name. So it's a mentoring organization. We started off as just mentoring young people and then progressing to alternative educational provision. So a lot of people call that pupil referral unit, but we provide respite for young people in education and support schools and teachers and parents with the mentoring and really signposting young people towards their passions. Mm. And that's really what we do, just educating people in a different way, alternative education.
For real. And, you know, why did you create it? What was there a need for it where you are?
Yeah. I grew up on the Ellsbury Estate, so Southeast London, in between Camberwell, Peckham, Old Kent Road, so if anyone knows it. But I grew up there in the 80s, and it was a difficult landscape to navigate. So it's just a basic culmination of all my life's experiences, all the things that I've gone through, trying to play professional football, trying to find my way in this world as a black man. Yeah. I just need the support. So this is why Mentivity came out of all my work experiences and life experiences. I just created this offer.
For real. And, you know, for those who are listening, how difficult or how easy has it been to create a project?
Been ongoing. It's been 5 years of blood, sweat, and tears, but it's all starting to come to fruition now. It's a blessing because, you know, when it's your own thing, it's different. You know, working on a Saturday, working on a Sunday, up at 2 o'clock in the morning, up at 5 a.m. It's different when it's your own thing. So for me, it's been a blessing. I've learned so much about myself and this journey of enlightenment. But it's also been great to have something which I can provide to people and that people really want to be a part of and are supporting. The community is really behind it. So I'm just super passionate about people and helping them on their journey of life. And that's my family background. You know, we're a bunch of educators, you know, originate from Jamaica and Barbados by way of the motherland. But we're just passionate about people and helping people on their journey of life.
For real. And, you know, I was looking through and I've seen some of the topics that you talk about. And one of them that really stood out to me because it relates to me as well is mixed race identity. And, you know, I think you're one of the first kind of, I suppose, outlets that I've actually seen talk about that. So what kind of things do you talk about to people when they come and ask you or whatever they might need?
To be honest, I'm pretty well versed in a lot of things because of my life experiences. I've travelled a lot. I've experienced a lot in my formative years growing up in Southeast London. But, you know, talking about mixed heritage, and I don't even like to say mixed race because it alludes to someone being different, a different race. There's only one race, it's a human race. So it's mixed heritage for me and mixed, you know, cultural backgrounds. And that's the important thing. I just want to change the narrative around a lot of things, you know, from policing to education to even the consciousness of people and the spirituality of people, and just bringing people on that journey of discovery, but at their own pace. Like, you know, I don't judge people. I'm not here to judge any people. You know, that's not my job. My job is to help people along their journey of life and spark those things in your mind where you can actually go on your own journey of discovery. And that's what I'm here for. And that's what I've been blessed by the Most High to do.
Definitely. And how did you get involved in the Black Awards? Because that's how we kind of got introduced virtually. So how did you get involved in that?
Just trying to support the movement. I'm down to support my people and anyone that is really struggling to overcome oppression and institutionalized kind of racism and oppression and just everyone that's on a journey of life. I'm just trying to raise awareness. I'm just authentic in terms of who I am. I don't pretend to be something I'm not. I'm just real with it, and anyone that comes out and reaches out to me, if I can support them and I know they're trying to do something positive, I'm going to work in partnership with them. That's how I am. It's not even about money. It's not even about that. It's about supporting people and us getting, you know, to a destination, which is enlightenment, you know, together and working in collaboration. So that's the most important thing. But I really like their concept and what they're trying to do.
Yeah.
Shining light on people and celebrating ourselves, because we don't celebrate ourselves enough and our achievements, especially being oppressed for how long.
Definitely. So tell us as well about the girls mentoring and what that entails, in case people are still looking at the name and thinking, oh, it's just for men. So tell us something, because people look at the name and think, oh, it's just for men. So tell us about the girls mentoring as well.
I mean, women underpin everything in society, so it's important that we provide a service for them which is led by women, but also led by the users, which are the girls themselves. Yeah. And there are some girls that respond well to being mentored by a man and someone that's from Southeast London, and they need that in their life. But when you're working with girls, it's totally complex. Boys are a bit more simple, even though they can be difficult with the ones that we're working with, but girls are more complex. And the reason is that they underpin everything, and you give them something, they multiply it. And if they're given something negative, they're going to multiply that.
Yeah.
So for us now, it's about being led by females in the community that have had their own struggles. And females are under attack. You know, if you're a woman in this world, it's very difficult. But if you're a black woman, and you know, it's like a double dose of negativity and struggle. So what we're trying to do is just raise the awareness of what we're doing young people, especially women as well, and provide that support. But it's all about balance. You know, we've got to be able to work in conjunction with each other. And if we don't understand each other from a cultural context, but also from, you know, a context where I'm a man and that's a woman, and we got to understand the differences between us, then we're never going to progress. So it's all about the unification of people, unification of the society, and the human race, to be honest, because we don't, you know, neglect anybody. If you need help, then we're going to support you if we can. You know, we're working as far away as Brighton, West Sussex, Kenya, Uganda. It just doesn't matter. We'll work with anybody.
For real. You know, who influences you and your inspirations? Because you seem quite together. So tell us. You're laughing. So, you know, tell us who inspires you, who influences you.
First and foremost, the most influential person in my life is my mother. My mum is my everything. Without her, I wouldn't be on this journey. My mum's a very strong, spiritual, conscious woman, and she has raised, you know, 7 children almost single-handedly, and I'm the oldest of those 7 children. So my mum is my greatest influence. I do everything that I do because my mum's allowed me that platform and support me along the way in that journey of life. And if we're talking about significant people, Bob Marley is definitely someone that has influenced me from a young age, hearing Bob Marley every Sunday, and just his revolutionary spirit. I love Bob Marley, like, to the core. I love everything that he did and what he represents, and his legacy is still strong today.
Definitely.
Malcolm X is my guy. The revolutionary in him, I'm a revolutionary at heart, and that comes from my family and our consciousness and our spirituality.
Yeah.
But we're underdogs in this world, and Malcolm, Bob, Martin, Marcus Garvey, they're all underdogs, and they came to such, you know, fruition and came to such prominence because they believed in telling the truth and believed in trying to raise the consciousness of their people, but also overcome the systems of oppression and inequality that keep us down to this day. So there are many influences, you know, from the Black Panthers. There's so many, but I'm just grateful that those people were able to lay the foundations before me to do the work that I'm doing now.
Definitely. I'm liking the vibes. I'm liking what you're saying about the different influences, because we seem to be on the same level with that. And, you know, big up your mum. You have to big up your mum every time.
Always.
So if she's listening, big her up. And so what would you say to people in our community that would say, well, nothing's changing, so what's the point? Because I hear that pretty much all the time. But what would you say?
I'd say if you have the outlook, then the system is one.
Yeah.
And the system is designed to keep us down. It's, you know, we're the 99%. We decide when things stop, but we don't understand that the collectiveness and the spirit that we have as a unified people is more important than anything else. And if we want to influence that change, and we can do that, you know, there's a real spiritual shift that's happening right now, a real kind of rise in consciousness across the world, because of what's going on, especially with COVID and, you know, these lockdowns, and people are having to take time out for themselves. So it's very, very important that we rehabilitate ourselves individually, understand where we're at or where we're not at, so that we can then progress ourselves. Because unless we do that individually, then we can't do it collectively. So for people that are saying that there's nothing that we can change, yes, we can. It's about accountability. Even though there are systems in place to keep us down, there is those systems we can use to empower ourselves by holding them to account through those same systemic kind of things that they put in place. So for me, everything's got to be about solutions. I was probably one of those people when I was younger where I thought I couldn't do certain things. But now, through educating myself, being more informed, and now being more empowered, I know I can pretty much influence change in any facet of society. You know, working with the Met Police, which I'm influencing the whole training. I'm going to change that whole organization, unlike anyone has done before, because I know I can do it and I'm passionate about it. But also, I'm going to utilize my community and mobilize the community to make those changes and hold them to account in a way that's never been done before.
For real. And you know, we had, and I suppose we still got a little bit of it now coming up throughout the different social media platforms, but Black Lives Matter and the whole movement from last year, when people seen, you know, George Floyd and how he was killed, do you think, you know, that's actually started to change people's mindsets and actually see it like live on kind of Facebook and those things have actually helped? Or
it has helped in a sense that it's brought it to the consciousness of people that otherwise wouldn't have seen it. Because where we were in the position where we were all locked down in our house, everybody was focused on social media and the news, everyone saw it and you couldn't escape it. And what that I think that highlighted in the way that he was killed and murdered was that he was not doing anything wrong. And this has happened so many times before. But because we've been so engrossed in our own lives and at this such fast pace, we never took time to really notice it. So for me, I think it's just raising the consciousness of the Black struggle. And me personally, I much prefer the Black liberation movement, because it's about liberating ourselves from this systemic kind of evils, really, where we can be killed in plain, you know, sight and in daylight. So I think with George Floyd, it was a catalyst for a start of a change that's going to happen, you know, unlike never before. I think we're in the midst of a mini revolution. It's already started in people's minds, and we've got to change, because I think a lot of people, not just Black people, people from all walks and creeds of life have just said, we've had enough. We can't stand by and watch this happen anymore. So I think there's now a collective kind of ideal around change and change for the better, and the system's going to try to stop it, but it can't be stopped.
For real. You know, I know you work with lots of young people, and one of my concerns is obviously during this time with locked in mental health, have you seen a rise? Because we're always told on the TV that there's a rise in mental health. How about yourself? Have you seen that within young females and young males?
Oh, for sure, for sure. This has been a ticking time bomb way before COVID. It's just been further compounded by the complexities and the lockdowns and things like that around COVID, and also the inequality when it comes to finances, because people are now struggling to actually survive. You know, this is supposed to be, you know, the first world country, and we've got people on the streets that are starving and struggling and committing suicide because it's just too much. So this is a ticking time bomb which has been ticking for many years, but with the last 10 years of Tory cuts and, you know, 4.7 billion that's been taken away from education, essentially, that's what it would take to reinvest in education in 2022, 2023, to bring us back up to where it was in 2009. We've had £1 billion of cuts when it comes to youth services over the last 10 years, since 2010. And we're taking so much away from young people, but still expecting them to do great things in the world. But they're being led by a system that's almost psychotic, because you want to celebrate billionaires on the front page of Forbes and stuff, and people are still dying in first world countries, you know, and to use their terms. So this system is failed, and it's failing young people. So it's now down to us, you know, community organizations and adults, to actually lead the way and empower young people to actually make the changes that they want to see.
For real. And, you know, let's talk about the positives. What kind of positives have you seen? Because we always like to talk about positives as well.
Yeah, I mean, during COVID was a great time for Mentivity, because we actually were recipients of the Fund for Racial Equity from Goldman Sachs, and just consolidated our partnership with them, and they donated £125,000 to us as part of the Fund for Racial Equity, which was in response to George Floyd and his murder and the kind of changes that were happening in society. So we were able to run something called the Raising Aspirations Project, where we engaged about 50 young people over 11 weeks and helped them in terms of finding their passions and realigning themselves, really. And out of that, we had 3 young people set up their own businesses, 4 young people reintegrate back into mainstream education, and just more focus. And what we're really now is doing is just mobilizing the community, and we've got people behind us now. We're having such great conversations with corporations and, you know, Hogan Lovells, which is a law firm, as I said, Goldman Sachs, Deloitte. We're now in a space that we wouldn't have been if it wasn't for COVID. So it's been a blessing in that respect. And the young people that we're working with are beginning to flourish because our young people are so adaptable and they're so flexible because of the way the world has treated them that they can navigate this now with a little bit of support. Mm-hmm. And this is the time for entrepreneurs. And if we can get that spirit in young people from now, you know, as a people, we've been great at overcoming things and making the most of nothing and very little. So this is nothing new to us. We're surviving. This is a survival stage, and this is the next stage of it for us. So our young people are just doing really well. They're doing so well. I'm proud of them.
Yeah, for real, definitely. So what's next for Mentivity? What kind of things can people look forward to?
There's a lot of things in the pipeline. I've got to be careful because I don't want to announce things before they've happened, but they're pretty much on the way. But for us, is the consolidating our space in the community, having our own school. That is our real focus, where we want to showcase to government that this is the way that you have to educate young people from specific backgrounds, especially in Southeast London, and those that don't have much, you know, and don't have much aspiration. So we're trying to create a great model around education, working with the police. We'll be running training for all the 12 borough commander units in London, which is fantastic for us, trying to change that shift around the police and that negativity, but also educating our community how to negotiate stop and search, how to negotiate law and understand certain things about them. We are running a football team with the Wall of Comedy, the Wall of Entertainment, should I say, called the Wall FC. So myself and Leon are the team managers. There's so much coming up. We will have a major couple of announcements in the next few weeks in regarding to having our own sort of premises. So that is really big for us. So lots of things coming. And 2021 is a good year for us already.
Definitely. I've just got a question in from one of the listeners. They've said, how are the police taking to your training?
To be honest, very well, to be honest, because the way that I've posed it, I've not gone in there and pointed fingers and saying, you're institutionally racist, you're racist, I can't stand you. Yeah. They've heard all that before. You know, that kind of angry black man approach is not going to work now. Well, I've gone in and I'm having open, honest conversations around the issues that we've had, but also how they see the black British community, which is important, because you got to understand where they're at before you can actually start to educate. So it's about meeting in the middle and sharing my experience of being assaulted at the age of 14. I've been assaulted, 3 times by police officers. Nothing's come of it, taken it to court, it's been thrown out, nothing's happened. I've been stopped and searched over 30 times since the age of 14. So I'm probably the person back in the day who couldn't stand the police, even up until probably last year. However, I realised the importance of now communicating, sharing experiences, but educating those that are ignorant to the fact that what they're doing is oppressing the people. So it's been received really well. There's a buzz within the police because they don't want to be seen as a negative people in society, because a lot of them are trying to do good. There is a minority in the police force that need not be there. Yeah. Just the same in our community, that we've got a lot of people doing great things and we don't celebrate it, like I said. That's why the Black Awards is so important. But also we have a minority in the community that are doing negative things. So we can't say that it's everybody. We've got to really now get to the crux of the issue. And it's a communication, a lack of respect and understanding. And also, who are we recruiting for the police? These are people that don't even know what London is about. They're from rural parts of the UK. So it's about educating. You know, I asked them in the training, I said, out of 25 people, I said, who's ever had jerk chicken in their life? They didn't even know what it was.
Oh my God.
So, right. So you're going to come and police people in Brixton and Peckham and you don't even know what jerk chicken is. Like, come on. There's got to be some cultural education. And that's what I'm trying to do, is give them a well-rounded kind of introductory education, but also around the experiences that we face and how difficult life is for us, because they don't know these things. They go to films to see what our culture is, you know, Boys in the Hood. And I'm like, that's from 90, in the 90s. Like, that's 30 years ago. What's going on? Like, why are we talking about that? So, you know, they want to look the top boy. And I'm like, yeah, that's a kind of microcosm of our society, but that's not us. You've got to, you know, integrate and understand what's going on. So it's going really well, and I'm looking forward to what it's going to bring in terms of changes to our society.
Definitely. And, you know, I'm liking everything that you're saying. It sounds very positive. Even the negatives that have been there, you're trying to find a positive, which is always a blessing. So I just have to big you up as well for doing what you're doing for our community and the wider community as well, because if you're training the police, then hopefully they'll treat everyone the same. So that's a blessing. So how can people link and connect with you if they wanted to get a part of the program, even just have a chat with you? How can that happen?
Yeah, you can find us on Instagram at Mentivity. That's how you can keep up to date with what's going on. We have a website, www.mentivity.com. You can check us out there. We're also on Twitter. But Instagram is really our main focus. We've actually got an exhibition down at King's Cross by King's Boulevard, which celebrates and showcases the work that we do and the young people that we work with, but also the families. And just those that inspired us on our journey of getting towards Mentivity, which is run by myself, my brother Tyson, and Leon. We're the three directors, so you can check that out. But if you go at Mentivity on Instagram, you can find out a lot of information, a lot of links to what we're doing and our resources.
Definitely. I've already checked it all out. Already liked and followed and everything like that. So I would definitely encourage people to go and just see what you're all about. I'll have a chat with you for real. Is there any kind of final thoughts you want to say to the listeners out there before we say goodbye for now?
Yeah, you know what I will say? Today has been a great day for me personally, just in terms of understanding that where I can go. And I want people to remain positive and invest that time in yourself. It's so important right now. Because if you don't do that, you're never going to get another opportunity like this again to do it. And just stay positive. You know, do what you can in terms of staying connected with people, but really prioritize your mental health right now is so important. And really have those conversations around that and have those difficult conversations with people and your loved ones, because we're in uncertain times right now.
Definitely. Like I said, I just want to say thank you to you. Keep doing the great work that you're doing. And if you need any kind of boost or support on the radio, you know I'm here for you.
I appreciate you. I really do. Thank you so
Anytime.
Much.
Thank Speak you again having. Soon, yeah?
For sure.
Okay.
All right.
Blessings. Bless.
Right. Bless. Bye.
Yes, people, please do go and support Mentivity. Go and see what they're all about. Definitely positive for the community, positive for everybody. Please do go and support them. Go and check out what they've been up to, what they're doing. If you want to have a chat, please do go and check him out and see what he's all about. But right now, we're taking it back to coffee. Here we go.
Them think it's a joke. Sister, down to them.
Oh, yeah.
It's real.
Never before.
Do you have any doubt? This one for talking about.
Under the pressure, yeah, under the pressure, under the pressure. If your boy trouble take away now, we cheat in a second, cause we all under pressure, my friend. Sometimes when you feel it, you cry down. I hurt your heart, you know, but do not make it stress, cause it I feel be better, not be living in the ghetto, feel be under the